Well, I hope everyone had some nice holidays. Glad to see you all back.
Let's, I'll quick call the council together and just like to make a few general remarks. I appreciate everyone coming out today and for the last 3 years, everyone around this table and your staffs for all the hard work you've done. I think we've made some great strides and we're all working together. And I just want to say thank you for all that you've done along the way here. Just for a little bit of background for those who don't know, this Workforce Planning Council has been in effect for many years, but was a little stagnant, I think. And back in 2013, Executive Order 313, we reconstituted the council and changed some of the members, added members, especially some of our secretaries, to basically come up with a holistic approach to training their workforce. And you know, each of these people around the table here represent a different department, a different agency, but one way or another, they're all involved in training their workforce in West Virginia. And you know, I think that by looking at it, you know, from a holistic approach, we can't just take one program and say this is what's going to, you know, create a perfect workforce for West Virginia, but it's going to take all of us working together at all levels. And that includes starting with our very, very youngest ones, and that's preschool, that through legislation and otherwise, we've been able to come with some great programs and be getting national recognition, especially on our pre-K. But not only that, getting kids involved early with education and make sure they understand the importance of it. You know, you've got to continue to move throughout pre-K through 12 to give the our students a good foundation in order to be productive citizens. And that's where I think we've come a long way, but we still got a long ways to go. But not only with the pre-K programs, but our goals to have children reading at grade level in the third grade, I think is very important. Studies have shown that without that happening, those students get farther and farther behind, usually dropping out, not becoming part of the workforce, but maybe become a part of the state system in not so good a way. So anyhow, that's, we're doing that. We also realize the importance of how important it is that kids think about a career and what they're going to be doing early, as opposed to waiting until they're juniors and seniors in high school when they say, well, this is what I'd really like to do, but I needed training 3 years ago. I need to be thinking about these things. So we've had initiatives that Dr. Monterano will talk about dealing with that issue. We've also set a goal out there that every student graduating high school in West Virginia will be able to go into the workforce with the training they've got, or additional training, or into higher education and make a smooth transition there. So with that said, we'll start at the very, in my opinion, the beginning stages of getting our people ready to be good, productive members of our workforce. And, but knowing that if you look at some of them, especially in middle school, within 5 years, they will be our workforce or starting. So, Dr. Monterano, you want to start as our state superintendent of schools?
Absolutely. Sir, I'm going to take a point of personal privilege and just a little bit digress. I want to commend your leadership as our governor. I have been a professional educator starting as a classroom teacher for over 30 years. And when you have a governor who understands the significance of education at the level which our governor does, it has been an absolute joy, for lack of a better word, to work with you, because you understand those articulated processes from a vertical articulated level and the significance that it plays with all the other entities of our state. So goes an educated populace, so goes our state. And you have embraced and have led in a way that I have never seen any other elected official that I've worked with in my 30-plus years. And I'd like to take that point of personal privilege by asking, please give our governor a round of applause. And again, I'm so proud to work with you. And again, the initiatives of which we've put in place during your tenure as our governor, and you've just been just uncompromising in terms of our focus. You and I have had conversations throughout your tenure. Phone calls, a variety of things, whether it's maintaining 180 days of instruction, whether it has been the issues in terms of our accountability system, But a major focus of your leadership during your tenure has been the focus on our early childhood and our focus regarding our children in terms of our third grade reading initiative. And then ultimately, leading to that incredible focus in terms of where our graduation rate is, that during your tenure, the graduation rate has risen to the highest levels ever as a state. We are at 89.81 for all of our young people. And that's just not some of our students. That's disaggregated based upon our students of poverty, our students of African-American individuals, our students of Caucasian individuals. And in the nation, if everything were to remain constant, our graduation rate would be number two in America, because the more young people that graduate college and career ready, we know the better off our state's going to be. And when young people drop out of school, we know what occurs to them as far as the challenges which they have. So this is absolutely beautiful in terms of the music of which we're able to sing from today. And focusing in on our early childhood, it was about a month and a half ago that the Secretary of Education came to the state of West Virginia. And the headline in the Charleston Gazette was a model for the nation, our early childhood program, our pre-K program, indicating that we have a program based upon the support of your leadership, our legislature, and our stakeholders, where 80% of our four-year-olds are participating in pre-K. That's a phenomenal statistic, because the best way to attack the educational problems and the educational concerns within our nation is not to react when they are in high school, because hard to believe, in some cases, it's too late. Young people don't have the credits, they have not have the ability to continue to stay in school. But attacking it at the root cause issue of attacking the issues of literacy and numeracy at the early stages to ensure that young people can get off to that right start, which ties into the aspect of why our governor's been so focused in terms of his leadership, knowing the focus regarding third grade reading. If a child cannot read by the beginning or the end of grade three at a proficiency level, they are destined to drop out. The data does not lie. So understand that as we put more emphasis on our early childhood program, our four-year-olds, 80% of our students participating, smaller class sizes, linking our collaborative learning with our Head Start programs, our private sector, all of those things working together, we front-loaded our focus, making certain young people can read, because again, when they can't read, they start falling further behind and they drop out of school. The data again supports that. So we're very, very pleased with the initiative in terms of the amount of dollars that have been associated with it, that have been targeted and well used. You always hear when we're talking about our budget cuts that this is one example of judicious use of dollars, where we're getting the most bang for our buck, where we're taking a focus in terms of making certain that we're reaching out to our community, to our students who don't necessarily have all the advantages, students who are from less humble means. And again, with the reauthorization of the Education Secondary Education Act, better known as ESSA at the federal level, a major component of that, Governor, and you know this better than I do, is the aspect of equity and access. Not just some children, but all children. And when we live in a state where many of our young people live in poverty, we've done everything that we can to scaffold a program for them so that they're able to succeed. So I have a wonderful handout for you that you know better than I do, that memorializes all of these wonderful facts and statistics that again leads in to not just at that level, but with a vertical focus leading from pre-K, actually from birth, pre-K, third grade, moving into middle school, where students are then able to select in terms of what their careers are. Again, moving into high school, where they have the ability to be going into advanced placement courses, taking advantage of the dual credits with our collaboration with our higher ed colleagues, which we enjoy a tremendously robust, positive relationship with our higher ed entities. And then ultimately, our career development, and I'm not going to take Dr. D'Antoni's thunder, but I got her first thing in the morning after our holiday, and I said, if I talk 10 times, I talk 110 times over the holiday, anybody who would listen to me, Governor, you know I have no problem with words. And I'll talk to you.
I know.
I'm a little passionate. It's a new year. I'm trying to self-regulate.
Hey, I look about 2 weeks later.
I'm going to get my money for it. I'm truly get my money. To continue, sir, I'll miss the beat. We're talking about our simulated workplace environment and our tiny homes. And so, sir, with that, I will end my comments by saying, as you leave, your legacy in terms of your impact on education has been absolutely remarkable. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Allen. Yeah, and as I mentioned in my earlier remarks, the other initiative we put together in cooperation with the State Department of Education and our Department of Commerce was My State, My Life. I know that many of you saw that. It's aimed basically at middle school students. Every school in the state has it, was sent to them. Their counselors have it. And basically what it does, it's really, first of all, urges kids to stay clean, stay off drugs, and get to think about the career, what you're going to be doing if you're an eighth grader in 5 years down the road, and not wait till you're a junior or senior. And basically it is spelled out or showed many of the jobs that are high earning jobs in West Virginia and what you got to do to get there. Basically it's, you know, keep your nose clean and study hard and talk to your counselor about what kind of classes that you need to be taking in middle school to get to what your goals are out there. So that's one of the things. The other thing that we used to have such a problem with in transitioning from high school to either higher ed in the community or four-year colleges was the amount of remedial education that had to be done, sometimes 1 or 2 years, to get them up to that standard. And basically what we're doing in our high schools now, we're testing our kids. If by the junior year they're not where they should be, especially in math, then they can get the remediation through the summer or through their senior year in order to be ready to go on into the workplace or into higher education, a smooth transition. So I think that's a very positive thing we're doing. As Dr. Martirano said, we've changed in our public education system from the way it was when I was in school, having gone to vocational schools, to moving into the career workplace. And that's what Dr. D'Antoni has done. And you may have saw what some of her students from around the state did a couple of weeks ago to help members of the flood victims that we had back in the June floods to be able to build the tiny homes. And this was something, if you haven't been to one of these centers, it's pretty amazing. You have everything from the students being supervisors and safety directors to actual being in and whatever the program they're in, whether it's healthcare or construction or those things, you know, that they go into, and they all know their jobs. They're all drug-free, and it's a program I know Dr. D'Antoni is very pleased about. Kathy, you want to tell us a little bit about that?
The simulated workplace, it's our emerging workforce, and I've said it 100 times, it is probably the light of West Virginia. Our emerging workforce is amazing. These young people have really stepped up to the plate. The tiny homes is just one indication of what's going on. And out of that, our simulated workplace companies, we now have 24,000 students who are now a member of a company somewhere. Some are safety, as you mentioned, safety directors, some are CEOs, some are job foremen, but they're learning the processes of businesses. And we're now 8 states have come into West Virginia to view the simulated workplace. We have 7 of those states have started simulated workplaces in their home states. Alabama has almost taken credit for it. But we reminded them a number of times who started it.
We're not too competitive.
Yeah, exactly. But our drug testing, these students are drug tested. Happy to say that it's a 99% drug-free emerging workforce. I could just go on and on about of what's happening with our students. Out of the Tiny Home Initiative, the Career Tech Center at James Rumsey has entered a contract with the Habitat of Humanities. The CEO of that company entered the contract with them to build more tiny homes. Procter & Gamble has donated $25,000 to have a home built in that area. So these are the things that come out of this, and our young people are learning firsthand what it means to be in business, how you do the process, how do you do timelines, what all is involved to become part of the economy of West Virginia. So we're very excited. I do not have a handout, but I have the next best better thing, which is a young lady who is my handout. Rachel, this is Rachel Peel, and Rachel is from an engineering company at Fayette Institute of Technology. And Rachel, if you'll just take a couple of minutes to explain why simulated workplace has been successful and why you think it's important.
I think if you want to know the success of simulated workplace, you should kind of look at the impact that it makes on students' lives. I know that going through simulated workplace and having a part in the company at my school as the accountant has taught me so much responsibility, and it's given me such an insight into my education that I never had in a typical classroom setting. And I know that myself and my peers, we value so much learning how to do a resume and a portfolio and a job interview. It's pretty invaluable going into college or even looking to step into a career right after high school. We all feel much more prepared than we would have had we been, you know, having a typical classroom environment. And even the organization of the classroom, the way the five S's of keeping everything in order, it's just running it like a business. It's very valuable.
You coined a statement you made to me about 2 months ago. Would you please say what that statement was? Because I think it's perfect.
At the Simulated Workplace Summit, when we took questions, one of the statements I made was, simulated workplace makes okay students into great students and great students into leaders.
Thank you,
Rachel.
And one more thing to add to that is out of all this, the governor's credentials, workforce credential, has evolved. This year, for the first year, students, if they reach the criteria, can achieve a workforce credential, governor's workforce credential, which is very high criteria, grade average, attendance, graduation, work performed, community service, drug-free. It's a very high level that a student has to reach in order to earn the credential. So we're very excited about that. This year will be the first year that our students will be able to receive that, and we just look forward to wonderful things coming out of all of the career tech and our educational system.
And Karen, I think that as business people out there, if a student has that credentialing, then I think that's very important for them to know that if they have, you know, been drug-free, they've done the things that's been expected of them, and usually those will make good employees out there also. Also, just like to say to Rachel and about the other students at the different schools that I've visited, about the excitement in the classroom when you go in and ask a student what you do. I mean, they're anxious to tell you and excited, as opposed to, as you say, sitting in the classroom and saying, I read three chapters today. You know, right. It's that excitement out there that I think is really good. So anyhow, thank you again, Rachel. Everyone talks about STEM these days, and rather than just talking about it, I think we've been doing a great deal over the past several years, and Alyssa has been the one that's kind of headed that up for me, and I know she's very excited when you mentioned STEM. So Alyssa, why don't you touch on what the STEM committee's been doing.
Sure. Thank you, Governor. Since you established the Governor's STEM Initiative in 2015, the Governor's STEM Initiative has focused on a number of priorities. Those include expanding STEM instruction in West Virginia schools, fostering new STEM programs and activities, increasing public engagement in STEM, and connecting businesses with STEM programs around the state. So one of the recommendations that came out of your STEM Council report issued in 2014 was to establish a STEM clearinghouse. Essentially, it would be a one-stop shop for anything STEM-related for students, parents, businesses to be able to go somewhere to find STEM programs or activities that are occurring around the state. So Governor, I'm pleased to provide this information that the Governor's STEM Initiative, in collaboration with the Department of Education, received a grant from the Benedict Foundation to develop this website. The West Virginia Ecosystem website is a one-stop shop for those youth programs and activities around STEM. And it's we're hoping that the public launch will happen this spring, but we began work on the website, and you all actually have a handout in your packet. This is a screenshot of what the website will look like. I've been working very closely with folks at the Department of Education, as well as other education stakeholder groups, to begin to input information into this website. We're very excited. This is a collaborative project that we're working with Carnegie Science Center on, and we're hoping that we'll be able to, you know, engage with business and industry, as well as provide additional supports for schools around the state interested in implementing STEM programs and clubs.
Very good. Thank you. We also did What was there? Redesigning the capital?
Yes, the Minecraft competition. Yes, that was a very exciting competition. Yeah, we had 15 total winners in that particular contest. The governor, as you recall, I think originally we had 250 submissions to go through, convened a panel and had folks review those, and we were very impressed with the overall winners. So it's an exciting time for STEM in West Virginia, and Governor, through your leadership and the collaborative partnerships we've established, we're really making great strides to make sure that we're providing those opportunities for West Virginia students.
Okay, as we move along, I think we've made some great strides over the last several years by having two college systems, a community and technical college system, as well as our four-year institutions, because their services are needed, but they have two different missions as far as I'm concerned. And basically, our community technical colleges are turning out graduates and really are able to adapt programs quickly to get people trained for new jobs and new careers out there. The other thing I've been very proud of because of this council is the collaboration between our community colleges and our what used to be our vocational schools. That used to be, if you took welding 1 or 101 in vocational schools and you wanted to go on and advance your education a little bit farther, you would have to start all over when you got to technical college, take the same things. That makes no sense to us. So now there's a collaboration between our simulated workforces and our community and technical colleges. So, Sarah, I know that you've got a lot of programs that you've been working on. Why don't you run through some of those that really has become, we're doing a great job. Businesses are noticing how valuable those programs that you're doing is, and they're expanding each year. So you want to touch on that?
Yeah, thank you, Governor. So I'm going to touch on three programs quickly. The community and technical colleges in West Virginia serve two primary populations. The first are recent high school graduates, and the second are adults. The average age of our students is approximately 29 years old. Those two populations have very different needs, and so the community colleges have to be adaptable to fit both needs. So the first program that I'm going to talk about, our Career Pathways Initiative, is an initiative that works with the Career Tech Ed Centers and specifically those recent high school graduates. The other two programs are programs that work more with adult students. Dr. D'Antoni and I have been working to try to create a seamless pathway from career tech education into our community colleges. Frankly, the college matriculation of our career tech ed students is not what we want it to be. And a lot of that has to do with roadblocks that we've put in place that have not allowed courses to transfer between high school and college. And we both thought that that was, for lack of a better term, stupid. As did you. So we've been trying to change that and try to make those pathways more seamless. And we've focused on four primary sectors, which are the sectors that are growing in the state of West Virginia. So we're looking at manufacturing, we're looking at healthcare, we're looking at IT, and we're looking at the energy sector to see where we can find jobs, where we know that there will be jobs at the end of the tunnel for students, and get our career tech ed centers and our community colleges on the same page so that students can earn college credits while they're still in high school, which will reduce the amount of time that it takes them to a degree and hopefully encourages them to go into college differently than we have in the past. Your support on that, Governor, has been huge. You've come to our summits, you've talked to our community college folks, you've talked to our career tech ed folks, you've said that it's a priority, and because you've said that, they've made it a priority. And I think I'll speak for Kathy on this, that we both appreciate it very, very much. It's helped move that work along quite a bit. The second initiative I'm going to talk about is our Learn and Earn program. Our Learn and Earn program is a 50-50 wage match for internships between the state of West Virginia and business and industry. And so essentially what happens in this program is that a student is enrolled in, let's say, a manufacturing program and they want to work at Toyota. Toyota says to the school, and this is a case at Bridge Valley Community Technical College, I will take X number of interns. Toyota will pay for 50% of their wages, and the state matches 50% of their wages. And in that way, a student has to stay enrolled in college. They have to finish their degree, but they're able to earn a living while they're going to school. And this is important, as I said, because many of our students are adults. 29 is our average age. That means that our students have families. They have mortgage payments. They have payments, rent payments. They have car payments. They can't just stop their life and go to school. They have to be able to earn a wage while they're going to school and help help support their family. So the Learn and Program allows them to do that. I'm proud to say that we now have partnerships, internship partnerships with 30 companies in the state of West Virginia. Those companies include Gestamp, K-Mores, Quad Graphics, Frontier, Toyota, DuPont, Pike Electric, River City, and the list goes on and on. Our placement rate for students upon graduating from their programs is approximately 90% with the company that they did the internship opportunity with. There are also several additional industries or several additional companies that will sort of scoop up the graduates of these programs because they know how well trained our students are. Last year, Governor Yu, as you know, reallocated $250,000 for the Learn and Earn program so that we could expand it. Since I have been in this position or my previous position, we have typically run out of internship money somewhere around March. We ran out of it the 1st of December this year. Because of the way that you've promoted it, because of the way that our colleges have promoted it, we just have really expanded the opportunities for students to have these terrific internships that are so meaningful for them. And we've run out of money, which frankly is a good problem to have, I think, in this case. And we will search for ways to supplement that money, and I'm sure that we'll be able to find them. The third program that's on my list here, and I hope I'm going quickly enough, is our Bridging the Gap Consortium. So in 2013, the community college system was awarded a $25 million grant, TACT grant, from the U.S. Department of Labor. And we've done several things with that grant. I'm going to hit on three that I think are perhaps the most important for our students. The first is that we knew we needed to accelerate programs and we needed open entry programs. As Valerie and Russell have told me many times, students don't get laid off on a semester-by-semester basis. It would be great if they did, but they don't. They get really laid off on a random Wednesday or a Monday or a Tuesday. And we have to figure out how to get them into a program so that we can best utilize the money that comes through Workforce West Virginia for retraining to get folks into our community college programs. And so our open entry move towards more open entry programs has helped us do that. Additionally, when folks have been laid off, they don't want to spend 2 years going to college. They don't have that kind of time. They need accelerated programs. And so we've had to change the way that we're offering many of our programs to be in a condensed format. This grant, that $25 million, helped us to move the colleges forward so that they could implement programs in that way. It has also helped us implement a prior learning assessment. We just have built a very robust prior learning assessment for the entire community college system. And that is an acknowledgement of the fact that many of our adult students come to us with skills that they can get college credit for. Somebody who's been laid off in the coal mine probably doesn't need to take all the technical courses in an advanced manufacturing program. They probably know how to do many of those things, and we just need to be able to test them in a way that allows them to test out of some of those requirements. And also, we've created guided pathways to success. So, I mean, all of us who have been in higher ed before know that higher ed has taken a what I like to call a choose-your-own-adventure pathway to finishing college. But that's not the best way to finish college. The best way to finish college is to be told, this is the path that we need, this is what you need to do, these are the courses you need to take, and the sequence that you need to take them. If you choose to deviate from that, that's your own decision. But we're going to show you what you need to do to be successful. And so we've implemented those guided pathways to success for all of our students. I'm very proud to say that we promised within this grant to serve at least 1,400 students. To date, we've served almost 4,000. And so that number continues to grow. And I look forward to the way that this grant can continue to change the way that our community colleges are offering programs to all of our students.
Okay, very good. We'll skip down to the end of the table. We got our Secretary Karen Bowling of the Department of Health and Human Resources. You may wonder what Health and Human Resources has to do with training our workforce. And you know, it has a whole lot to do with it. Basically, the health and welfare of our people is very important if you're going to hold down a job and get the training. But one of the things that we kind of brainstormed around this table with was a program that we kicked off last year, because we do have, first of all, we're reminded constantly of our low participation rate in our workforce out there. But secondly, we have a lot of people in this state that gets TANF benefits, and you know, and a lot of times those people, it's not the short term that they were expected to be, but sometimes they become generational. And so I asked Karen one day, I said, you know, what can we do if we use some of the TANF money if these people are wanting to get into a training program. And she got the permission to do that, and basically we kicked off the program at Southern Community College last year. Karen, you want to give us a, it's a very positive story, though.
It is. Thank you, Governor. And, I'd like to start by thanking you for including me in this workforce meeting. I think it is critical, as you pointed out, Governor, to understand that you were a visionary. I mean, a holistic approach does require us to consider all the needs of the people that we serve and to make sure that we can get people into workforce. Many of those folks are people that are served by the DHHR. So I appreciate the opportunity to be part of this, and I've always appreciated your leadership on this issue because it's so important. We have two initiatives that I think deserve some brief discussion because, as the governor pointed out, TANF is temporary assistance for needy families, and that's really what it is. It's temporary assistance. Our goal really is to make individuals self-sufficient. That's what we want to do. We believe that's important for family stability. So in 2015, the governor signed into law legislation that basically reformed our TANF program. And part of that reform was really about how do we help people get an education, how do we help them get training, and it's all a result of a lot of the discussions that we had here in this room, Governor, that you led that helped us think differently about what we need to do to help our TANF recipients. Because of those changes that we made in our TANF policy, we actually have been able to decrease our workload in TANF by about 18%, which really in turn means that there are people that get into our program and then we're able to successfully transition them out into the workforce or into an educational program that's long term. So that was very, very important for the state of West Virginia because we have many people out there that want to work, they just need the education and training. The second piece, as the governor pointed out, was really our partnership with the community technical college system because, again, for us to be able to be successful, we have to be able to support our clients. So in this room at one time, I was discussing this concept that the governor brought up of what do we do to help our TANF recipients with community college presidents, and I have to commend the First Lady. She at the time was president of Southern, and she stepped up and said, what do you need to do? Let's create a pilot, let's make this pilot work, and we did. We got permission from the federal government to use the funds a little bit differently, and our program at Southern was a huge success. We have really thought about what it is that our clients need to help them to continue in the education program, and you're gonna hear me talk about a success story in just a moment. But I would like to say that our success at Southern led us to expand it to the entire state of West Virginia, the entire state of West Virginia. And if you think about the community and technical college system and how we can partner and work together to help our recipients, the expansion throughout the entire state was critical. We are serving over 170 individuals. That's 170 individuals that likely would not be in an education program had we not put this program in place. So I appreciate the chancellor, all the college, community and technical college presidents, and everyone who's participated in this. And I know that this you're going to hear one success story, and I'm going to talk about her, and we're going to give her an opportunity to speak. I have my own pamphlet, too. But I think it should inspire us all to recognize that the hardworking people in the state of West Virginia, sometimes things happen and they just need help. And that's what we're here to do, is help them get what they need so they can become self-sufficient. So my example is an early success story. Remember, this program's very new and hopefully it's gonna continue to have more and more success stories. But I'm gonna talk about Brandy Schultz. Ms. Schultz actually graduated in May of 2016 from Southern West Virginia Community Technical College with an associate degree in the arts, a Board of Governors associate in science, and a certificate in general studies. Before starting Southern, Ms. Schultz worked as a waitress and had her three children and had trouble making ends meet. She came to DHHR for help, that's what we do. And her caseworker told us her about the Community Technical College program at Southern, and she enrolled in the program and continued. After graduation, in 2 weeks she found a job. 2 weeks after graduation she found a job. And I think that again should tell us a little bit about her and her individual effort and what we can do as a state to help people. She met her educational employment goals, and now she's in a position that she's going to talk about where she can help the vulnerable citizens in the state of West Virginia. So I'm very pleased to introduce you all, Brandy Schultz. Brandy?
Hi, it's nice to be here today. In 1998, I graduated from high school, and I ran off to Arizona with a Marine, got married, and had a kid. I gave up on all of my dreams and my aspirations. Well, I didn't know 10 years later I was going to end up divorced on my own with a child, no way to take care of myself or her. So I took about 3 years and I worked trying to make ends meet. I was a waitress, I was a cashier, I couldn't do it. I went to the HHR and I met a wonderful worker who pointed me in the right direction. She introduced me to the ANIP program, West Virginia Works, and the Excel Work Simulated program to get me ready to be on my own. She sent me down to Southern Community College in Mount Gay, and I talked to the liaison there, got me started on classes. I spent the next 3 years absolutely just working my behind off, trying to make it through these classes. And the more I looked at my schedules, the more I realized that instead of just graduating with one degree, I could balance everything around and I could graduate with 3 degrees. And I did. Last spring, I graduated with 2 associate's degrees and a certificate. And like she said, within 2 weeks, I was hired at NECO of Logan, where I work with foster children and with CPS cases trying to reunify families. And this coming fall, I'm going to Lindsay Wilson to get my bachelor's degree so that I can move up into foster care. The program that they have is absolutely amazing. They have helped me out so much. I could not afford to feed my children and go to college if it was not for this program.
Thank you.
That's a pretty inspiring story. Appreciate you being here. One of the other things that we used to have a little bit of problem with was our high amounts of dropouts. And once again, how does that affect the DHHR? But highest dropout rate of our students in the country. And obviously, we've tried to address that in many different ways. But usually, what happened when they dropped out of education, then Karen or Joe Thornton over at Division of Juvenile Services would get into it. And I know that Joey Garcia is here today to talk a little bit about that. I'm not going to get into you yet, Joey, but anyhow, Karen she's brought home so many kids and working with our truancy diversion specialist in all of our schools now, when they see a child starting to go down the wrong path, they can get them the help right there that they need, rather than sending them off to some place out of state or otherwise. They get the services now in state, and we have really cut down on the number of dropouts we've got, especially with our 15, 16, 17 year olds, and Karen, the number of those people that you have brought back, as well as keeping them out of the justice system, Joe, has just been amazing. And it don't sound like a lot, but sometimes there's kids that nobody wants to talk about, but they're a big part of our society. They could be productive citizens. I think we'll get heading in the right direction now, and the numbers are starting to show that. So anyhow, that shows what happens when you got two or three agencies that are working together trying to solve the same problem. And I just wanted to get that in there. Next, I'm going to call on Matt Turner with the Higher Ed Policy Commission to talk about some of the dual credits and statewide credit programs. This is another one that used to always drive me crazy, that if you went to a community college and you had English 101 and or whatever the class may be, and you wanted to transfer to Marshall, even from the old Marshall Community College, you could transfer that English class from Marshall Community College to Marshall University, which made no sense to me. English 101 should be 101 and taught to the same standards no matter what school you're in. So anyhow, over many years, finally between community colleges and higher education, we're talking about some of the transfers and dual credits. So Matt, you want to
talk? Absolutely. Good afternoon, Governor. Thank you. I was going over some of my notes here, and I would like to say that on behalf of the Policy Commission, really on behalf of college students, I think you have pushing the council and the commission as well, very much taken on what I call student-friendly initiatives. And I would, in fact, call it a completion agenda. And that is toward the efforts that you have pushed have really moved ahead the opportunities for students to complete their degrees. We have a lot of students who start college and do not finish. That's common across the country, but you know, in West Virginia, we're extra challenged with a lot of first-generation students who've never gone to college, and some of the things that you have helped enable are items that have been lurking for a long time. And we've been able to accomplish those actually in a pretty brief amount of time, considering how long those are. And transferability of college credits is one of those. You called for the improvement of transferability in your first State of the State address, I believe it was. And it's been a historical problem. As you mentioned, transfer sometimes between the community colleges and the four-year, the baccalaureate institutions, and getting those credits was not accepted, often not accepted. And that was a barrier to students completing their degrees. Not only does it cost more for them to retake the courses, you can imagine as a young student, we've seen it here, we've heard a story here just a minute, life gets in the way. Jobs, children, other things force them to go back to work or go to home. They drop out and they walk away with a number of credits that have been unused, and so they don't complete their degrees. So with your initiative, this barrier has largely been dissolved. Students who do have life get in the way and haven't completed their coursework now. We've worked somewhat quietly in the background, I would say, quietly for our side, but for you mentioning every week at a cabinet meeting, what's the status of the transfer, I think we've
a little prodding helps,
absolutely, because, you know, in a sense, we've had to bring together a lot of institutions. It's not just a matter of pushing an initiative down. We have a lot of faculty, a lot of different programs across the state, and a lot of institutions, 21, 22, I believe, to be, if you count all the campuses. So in 2015, working with the governor and our legislature, we passed, and with Joey's help here too, we passed House Bill 2867, which codified the acceptance of those credits for courses that meet what we call 70% learning objectives threshold. So if you've taken a course at this community college or even at this four-year school and transferred to this other four-year school, a private school to one of our public schools, if 70% of the learning objectives are met, then that is required to be accepted. So it eliminates the opinion, it eliminates a decision that could have perhaps been made by one faculty member. It also put in place an appeals process for the student. So we modified our rules to reflect this, and now we're proud to say we have 800 courses that are listed on the core coursework transfer agreement. And we're also working on, that's for foundational courses and core general coursework, but we're also working on a course equivalency list, which would allow for transfer of major foundation courses, so a chemistry course that could align with one if you continue in a chemistry major at another institution, not just the general coursework. It's been a lot of work, required a lot of collaboration among faculty and different institutions, but would not have happened without the drive from you and the push through the legislative process to make it happen. There are also now 85 articulation agreements, 2+2 agreements between the community colleges and the four-year schools that are in place. And we've also implemented a software program across all the institutions which enables students to see which courses are likely to transfer. So if life does get in the way, you have to drop out, you have to pick up a course somewhere else, you're able to tell in advance what's likely to work. So in short, in addition to the dual credit opportunities that are available to our high school students, who are able to start college, get a jump start at a reduced cost and get ahead. This is very student-friendly legislation, very student-friendly initiatives that I think put us on par or ahead of the country in a lot of ways and something that needed to be addressed. So we're very proud of that. And thank you for that. And I think the students will thank you too.
Yes, ma'am. The next department you know, what to think about as far as training and so forth is education in the arts. And you know, one important part of that, you really don't tie them together that much, but is our vocational rehabilitation for people with handicaps. And obviously, you know, we have our fair share of handicapped people in West Virginia. And I got Donna Ashworth here today who heads up vocational rehabilitation. But, you know, there's a lot of money there, a lot of availability to help those people to get them the training they need to live independently or to be productive members of society. You want to just convened Donna.
Yes, and again, Governor, I also would like to thank you very much for your support throughout your tenure in seeing that state funds and federal funds were maintained and used for individuals with disabilities. As most people here know, we lead the nation in individuals with disabilities, so it's important that we do take serious, and particularly youth with disability. The sooner you can let folks know, families know that students with disabilities can be successful, the sooner those individuals are going to go to work. And we do know that in our more rural communities, often folks become dependent on SSI. It almost becomes a cottage industry where these students get Social Security, and we have to convince parents that the disability can be overcome and that we can go to work and that we can be successful in school. And so we've been very successful. The West Virginia Division Rehab Services leads the nation in the numbers of individuals that we rehabilitate, not only for the first year, but for years following up, which, you know, now becomes the benchmark. And we don't hear that much, but we're very proud of what we've done. We are also very pleased that the new law puts us right with workforce, because that's where we think we should be. We are a program that works with individuals with disabilities to go to work. And so I think as we move forward with the joint planning and the joint state plan, I think the services to individuals are only going to get stronger. Right. So thank you.
Well, I can say from employers I've talked to who have hired people with disabilities, they're dependable, they can get their job done. You know, it's, you guys provide a great service for the high number of people who have disabilities. So we appreciate that. Next, we're going to kind of take a step away from education a little bit, in a way, and I'm with Keith, Secretary of Commerce, Keith Burdett, and his assistant, Chelsea Ruby, who's communications. Well, tell them what to say.
That would be correct. Communicated that well.
Which I think is very important. For years I think that whether it be higher education or just training or apprenticeship programs, this is what we offer, and whether there's jobs out there or not. And so we've decided, why are we offering programs if there's no jobs out there? And so basically what between community colleges and Keith's office, we've worked on a new program called Sector Strategies, basically to identify the jobs that are available with the kind of training programs we got. So,
thank you, Governor. Before I introduce Chelsea, who will clearly enunciate the strategy, let me tell you that the one thing I've learned in this job is that every state has assets and every state has disadvantages when it comes to when it comes to economic development. But the number one issue that you recognized early in your administration, the number one issue with every company and every consulting group that works with companies that are doing expansions or relocations is workforce. It hasn't always been the case, but I will tell you it is absolutely the number one issue. The number one issue with a bullet, because that's what they want to talk about. It isn't taxes. Yeah, they'll talk about taxes, but it isn't particularly the incentive parts. It is. Do you have a workforce skilled to meet my needs? And if you don't, how can you get one, or how can I get one? And what will the state be doing to advance that? And you recognize that fairly early in this administration. And it really requires a juggling effort between what you need today and what you need tomorrow. I will tell you, workforce development has been a solid part of our pitch to companies. And I describe it in a less artful but very clear fashion to a company when I talk about your involvement, Governor, in this process by trying to describe it in very blunt terms. Well, when he became governor, he fired everybody that was on workforce planning, and he made all the decision makers come to the table, and it has become a command performance. And that strategy has been recognized by not only companies, but the National Governors Association has said, look what Governor Tomblin is doing in workforce development. That's what everyone's going to have to do. If they're going to wrap their arms around the bureaucracies that that are involved with this to make something happen. So in the Department of Commerce, what we have tried to do through our marketing arm, which is really one of the largest marketing firms in the state, public or private, has been to try to start to convey more effectively to the public what those messages are. We've done it in three specific programs. One of our first one had to be was about drug-free workforces. But of late, we've been working on this sector strategy approach, which is to try to make sure people that want to go to work, want to know what their skills are, know what they're lacking, and know a way to get to where they need to be. Because that's an important part of the equation, is it's okay if you don't have the skills, you've got to have a path, a clear path, to know how to get them. And Chelsea and her group have done an amazing job in building an online effort. And Chelsea, I'll let you.
You've taken my whole 3 minutes.
Good.
I'll try to keep it brief. But this project actually goes back to something that I worked with Governor Tomlin on when I was in the governor's office. Several years ago, it was probably 3 or 4 years ago now, we were working on the governor's State of the State. The governor came in and we had this long list of programs from workforce and DHHR, all the different people around the table. And I said, we want to do something with job seekers. And we want to tell people the services that we have. And the governor said, well, you can't tell what it is from that list, because it was all these different acronyms and abbreviations. And he said, we've got to make this easier. So fast forward a couple years later, I'm working over at Commerce. Workforce comes to me and says, hey, we want to work on sector strategies. We want to work on making this easier. Can you help us put together a new portal? So this portal, while it was introduced as sector strategies, it's a lot more than that. It's actually a portal for all job seekers in the state of West Virginia. And everyone should have a copy of what it's gonna look like. But this is what it looks like. And Workforce's website gets about 3 million visitors a year. So anyone who's on unemployment, both on the job seeker side or companies who are paying unemployment taxes, come to this website. It gets a lot of traffic, and specifically, it gets a lot of traffic from people who are unemployed. So the goal of this project was to really boil down the resources that we have for them, and no matter what stage in the process they were in, we wanted to be able to help them get on the right path to getting a job. So if you look at it just briefly, stage one is going to be get your high school diploma or equivalency. So that's the most important step. Some people will come in and they'll move on to step four. They've already done all this. But it goes all the way through. You can take career interest tests. You can look at in-demand jobs. You can look at jobs in your county that are open. You can look at programs in rising industries, so projections for the next 10 years, when you're really trying to figure out what you need. Then on the education side of it, it tells you, you know, if you want to be an engineer, this is the degree you need. These are the schools that can get it for you. If you already have your degree, it tells you how to do a resume, interview skills, those types of things. So it's really an all-encompassing portal. And I think like I said, we get about 3 million visitors. I think it'll really make a difference. And I just want to thank you for telling me years ago to clean this up.
That's kind of blunt, but.
Well, in fact, Governor, let me close this section by saying something that I think is important. This has been a nice meeting, and there's a lot of people in this room. What the public ought to understand is that you have labored in this room for the better part of 6 years with almost nobody else here. The end product today is a result of not something that just got put together by my communications office or any of the rest of us. It is the result of really 6 years of working in this room as a group without anybody watching. And that is a great commendation to your commitment to this effort and the results that we're showing today.
The next guy who's, that's what he does, he gets people jobs out there every day. But obviously, you know, we've, the last 2.5 years, it's been a tough time for the economy, for business, for state government, for individuals out there. We're doing what we can as quickly as we can and to try to get people back to work. We've been very fortunate. Russ Frye has been the acting director of Workforce West Virginia for many years, and he knows the rules and the ins and outs of how to work with the federal government. He's been very successful in bringing home just hundreds of millions, well, millions of dollars. I don't know if it's hundreds of millions, but yeah, I'm sure it has been over a period of time. But to help those people that with training programs, there's a whole variety of everything from Workforce West Virginia, where we'll train people on the, or the guaranteed workforce, where we train people on site or whatever it is, and or to other programs, especially in the southern coal fields where the unemployment rate has been so high, and programs to help not only laid off miners, but their family, or anybody else that is interested in getting the training they need for a job. So, Russ, you want to touch a little bit on the Southern West Virginia Workforce Initiative?
I do. I have to thank you first. You're only as good as your leader. And you have, Keith, hit it. You've worked hard. And one of the things you said, and I know all the rules, I thought I did. You've challenged me.
There's a trend.
When the governor, when I make a statement, the governor hears it. He looks over at Keith and says, "That doesn't make any sense." Then I'm in contact with the regional office in Philadelphia, and we get it changed. And that's because of you. Truly, you have challenged workforce, and because of it, we have went out and got a lot of grants and things that have never been done. We wouldn't have done it because, you know, that just has not been the way things went. And the partnerships, I look around, we've partnered with everyone at this table. And prior to your bringing us together, we were over in our silo, and we were still the old unemployment office. That's how we were thought of. First meeting, I looked over at Kathy, and we've been best friends ever since. Because I said, "Kathy, I've just got some extra money for performance. Is there anything you could use that we can partner on? Simulated workplace." And it just went on and on and on. And it's just been a fantastic opportunity for me to work with you, and I've known you a long, long time. I tell you, it's just been a blessing. I had to say that. Now I'll talk a little bit about.
Now you're a whole big family.
Well, we'll see. but this Southern Workforce Initiative again was a result of yourself, and Larry Malone is here. Helped prod me. You know, sometimes you have to prod someone a little bit when you're already doing more work than you think you can, and someone has a great idea, you go for it. But we found out that we had in July, this past July, over 2,000 coal miners that had drawn all their unemployment, weren't looking for work, they just kind of parked. And we took the initiative. We'll just put a task force together and aggressively go after them, you know, just like we would if we were in private enterprise. And everyone that could be contacted of 2,100 has. Now, I will say that over 600 are just unreachable at this time, but we're still working at it. But we had 181 moved out of state, 289 disability or retired, 17 are just gone, and a few are now renting rent-free, living rent-free with the state. But the good thing was, in October we had 93 working, November 159 working, and I call, and as of today, 208 of those folks that have just given up are in employment. And not only that, we have right now 98 more either in training or in the process of being involved in training. So we've taken that group and starting to move it back in to the workforce where they need to be. So we're very proud of that. Also, another grant was, again, it's we've had the major dislocation in the coal field, which has been major. We've managed to start out with a small grant and continue to state our case. Now it's a $15 million grant to retrain coal miners. And when we started this grant, I actually said we won't get 50, so we'll start, you know, I think even then it was maybe a million or 3 million. But to see, we have 2,057 participants now in our grant. 1,532 have received training funds through the grant. The grant has already exited out of it 655, and 502 of those are already working. So they have a 77% entered employment rate first quarter. That means 3 months after they've gotten out of school. That's fantastic. And they wouldn't have been able to do that because there wasn't that kind of money here. And it also allows, like you said, the spouse, and also a training allowance of $100 a week, because if you couldn't get out in 26 weeks and your unemployment ran out, you were done. So this has been fantastic.
I think it's some of the other things that the community college system has done is been able to shorten the amount of weeks to accommodate those people.
That's part of the grant that we were talking about, that we went together on again. But again, thank you so very much for this opportunity.
Valerie's one with all the brains now. Well,
he's good.
I'll get you going again here. Valerie, do you have any comments on this?
Not other than to thank you for the opportunity, because I did go to some of the original Workforce Planning Council meetings many, many years ago, and you have really changed the group and turned the group around and steered them in the right direction with good leadership, and we appreciate that. We've done a lot of good things.
We appreciate that. Next person I'm going to call upon is one that the first time I met her and interviewed her, I was very impressed with her. She come a long way. She was one somewhat like Brandy, that had a slow start, I guess, but anyhow, she put it herself. She went from a GED to a PhD and sitting in the governor's office now. Carolyn is head of the Herbert Henderson Office of Minority Affairs and has done a great job in promoting minority businesses in the state, and minority employment. And you want to touch on your business expos and your job fair? I think was very impressive.
Thank you, Governor. First of all, I want to say, just like many others around the table, thank you so much. I really appreciate your guidance. I appreciate the support that you've shown to the Minority Affairs Office. When I first got invited to join this group, one of the things that we talked about is making sure that information is disseminated so that wherever your community is, whatever race or ethnicity you are, that you have the same information that everyone else has so that you can start to develop some equity in the services and programs that are being provided. And so that was one of the things that you really, Governor, supported, was making sure that information was able to be out there in all the communities. That was also done with the assistance of everyone around the table. I cannot tell you how valuable it is to be able to sit at this table and to hear from each agency what's going on, and to hear it firsthand, and to be able to ask questions, to get clarification, so that when you go out to the population you serve, you have firsthand credible information to pass on to that community. So I really appreciate that. I appreciate that in getting the Minority Business Expo started. Everyone around this table has offered so much support. As a matter of fact, this year, which was our third year, almost brought me to tears when I looked out in the group and I saw DHHR and Community College and Higher Ed and Workforce West Virginia. So I just really appreciate everyone at this table and the support that you've given me. So in making sure that information gets disseminated, one of the things that I started to think about was, how can we ensure that the greatest number of people get that information? And so we began to talk about holding a minority business expo. That Minority Business Expo brings people from all over the state. We have people from Wheeling, Martinsburg. That says a lot when you have a person that will drive 10 hours round trip to come to a 3-4 hour Minority Business Expo. With the help of the governor, who writes a personal letter, signs it, we'll see to it that folks are invited. We've been able to get corporations, the major businesses to come in, not only attend the expo and set up their shop and talk to people about what's available. There are things there from how do I start a business to how do I enhance the business I already have, and what do I do if I'm interested in starting a business, but maybe not right now. There are some other things that I need to do in the meantime. With the governor's assistance, these people from the community have come in, and they have supported the Office of Minority Affairs in a way to ensure that the Minority Business Expo is held year after year after year. Our inaugural expo, and I heard Secretary Burdett say this year he was the keynote speaker. He talked about being at the inaugural expo, and he said you had to stretch it to say you had 100 people in attendance. And 2015 and 2016 saw us go from that stretch of 100 people to 300 in attendance to 300 plus. And so, you know, that has, as a result of that, we've had a group of minority business leaders step up and establish the West Virginia Minority Business Association. And this is in an effort to bring businesses together and support them to share lessons learned, to be a part of the West Virginia Chamber of Commerce. And then with that being done at the expo, we start having people talk about, well, you know, it's hard for us to find a job. I'm not at the point where I want to open a business, but I'm not able to get a job. So working with Workforce and Russell Fry and Valerie and their company, we were able to look at, let's hold a job fair in a minority community that has a high concentration of minorities right there. And let's see, because we were getting feedback that where job fairs are held, sometimes it gets in the way of folks being able to get to them. So we held a job fair on the west side of Charleston, very first one, with over 40 employers and more than 400 potential employees came through that job fair. So that's the kind of thing that has come out of what the governor has put together and from the folks right here around the table. And I just certainly appreciate each and every one of them.
another group that you know, are very good, very well-trained individuals is obviously people who give most of our country to their veterans. And you know, it's one of those things that when sometimes when veterans come back trying to get back into civilian life, it's a little bit rough on them, and sometimes feel like they don't fit in for one reason or another. And obviously our Department of Veterans Assistance has done a great deal to try to get them back in and reacclimated to the communities and back into the workforce and training. And you know, there's some of the things that we've talked about in here is that I could drive a huge army truck, but yet I don't qualify for a CDL license. So you know, those are some of the things that we've been able to do to utilize the training. They've had highly skilled veterans coming back, and to be able to get them licensed and help out where they could. But also, in addition to all the other programs that the Acting Secretary Billy Wayne Bailey and his department does around the state through the local offices and everything, we've also partnered once again with higher education. And if I'm not mistaken, every higher education institution in the state has a veterans assistance officer to help do nothing but basically help veterans when they come in to get them the kind of special help that they may need if you know, have those services there. So anyhow, Billy, what do you want to touch on some of the things that
Yes, Governor. Thank you. First, I want to thank you for letting us have the opportunity as a department. Well, thank you for creating us as a department. Thank you for letting us have opportunity to make those partnerships with everyone around the table and a few people that aren't here at the table, such as Department of Agriculture, to take on programs that we've undertaken. We've taken the retraining money that we have for veterans and partnered with agriculture. Now we have 260 some veterans as beekeepers, and I know that doesn't sound very industrious, but we've got these big burly guys with big beards and tattoos, and they'll stand up and tell you how to take beeswax and make candles, and they're going out of state selling their scented candles and their wild honey and all these different things. But that's a business.
You don't have to have a beard to have bees.
I know you're a beekeeper too. Best daggone gardener in West Virginia, right there. We've started encouraging that, and as we saw the interest, we've also seen a lot of obstacles which you've helped us remove, and we created the Minuteman Training Foundation, which is the first and only to date apprentice program in agriculture in the United States. We've been approved by the U.S. Department of Labor, and we're getting ready to start our first apprentice here sometime soon this month with agreements with Parchment Valley and Department of Agriculture. And at the end of 2 years, our veterans will be able to perform 142 different tasks and be not only marketable to existing farms, but be able to go and use that training to go to a financial institution and say, we want to buy 2 or 3 acres and start farming ourselves. So that those are the things we're doing. Also, we've taken our programs and of course, we're having the VFW, their big push is mental wellness for veterans, and PTSD and suicide prevention. These are the kind of things that we're faced with every day in the veteran community. We are trying to take our training and make it part of their therapy. And I met with one of the undersecretaries of the VA Thursday before Christmas, who was from West Virginia. And he dropped by my office to say hello, and I explained to him what we were doing with our veterans to agriculture and how it could be a part of the mental health therapy for our veterans, and he's taking this back to Secretary McDonald. So I'm hoping to hear something before the end of the week from them, see if the Secretary's actually interested. So these are the things that we're doing, and it's your leadership that's led us to that this point. Thank you very much, Governor.
Notice Donna is riding with interest down there. That may be something that, especially with our wounded veterans coming back, that they could help with that program. Thank you, Billy Wayne. A couple more of the initiatives that we've worked at and I think has been successful. It helps with our workforce and helps keep people hopefully out of trouble. And the first one is justice reinvestment, and the second one, it's juvenile justice reform. And Joey Garcia has been my point person on both those initiatives. Joey, you want to touch on those and the successes we've had there?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Governor. It's one of the pleasures I've had working for Governor Tomlin is seeing these two initiatives, justice reinvestment, criminal justice reform, and juvenile justice, be really centerpieces of his legislative agendas, and also in working out how you make these policies work. And one of the things that he's made clear, both these initiatives have to do with public safety, fighting substance abuse, fighting truancy, but all that relates to somebody being able to have a job at the end of the day. Somebody, first of all, if you're on drugs, you can't get a job or you can't get hired. And similarly, if you have a job, you're much less likely to get into things that will lead you down to those troubled paths. So much of what's been done with justice reinvestment around this table, I think the Workforce Planning Council, it shows this theme that's been going on here, that not letting the status quo remain, and that simple changes can actually have a great effect. And so a few examples of this with justice reinvestment and juvenile justice. Number one, the governor asked around this table, so what are some things that are keeping people who have either been arrested or spent time in prison from getting employment? And Workforce West Virginia really went together with our Division of Corrections, with parole, And now several things have happened. Number one, we have a bonding program, which nobody knew about before. And it was there for employers to use. $5,000, as simple as could be, that an employer could use this money so that a person who may be a little bit of a risky hire, if they would break something, if they would steal something, now an employer free of charge could have a bond that would protect them for up to $5,000. And this is something that, again, it was there, but it wasn't being used. Workforce also worked to make sure that their website, which is the place where they need to track information about how people are getting jobs, how they're applying for jobs, that every person that goes on parole actually has to sign up for the website. And that's become a condition of parole now, and it's been very helpful. Similarly, the governor early on asked the question about the Division of Rehabilitation Services. Isn't substance abuse a disability? And so we worked with the Division of Rehabilitation Services, and they said, well, we currently don't have that in our policies, but that's the way it should be, and let's change it. And that back in 2013, they did that, and they've continued to work and have relationships with parole officers, trying to get people the help that they need, especially when it comes to substance abuse. And third, one of the other things that relates to adult criminal justice reform, you have an impediment to employment is if somebody can't drive to work. And that had come up, and I remember hearing about it for many years, and it just wasn't something that the legislature or any other agency could crack. How do we get this fixed? So last year, after a lot of talk and after a lot of collaboration, the William P. Laird IV Driver's License Act was passed, where individuals could start on a payment plan through our Division of Justice and Community Services. And while they were paying, they wouldn't have to wait until they were done paying their fines and fees from having committed a crime, but they would actually have their license while they were paying, so they could go to work, so they could actually pay the fines. And it was something, all these things have one thing in common. They're so simple. And all it took is getting people across the table to talk to each other and to try to figure out how to solve the problem. And then when it comes to truancy and with juvenile justice, which is, that's been since 2015, having people across this table with Dr. Martirano, with the Department of Education, with Secretary Bowling, with DHHR, and you usually wouldn't necessarily think when you're talking about juvenile justice, that's who you deal with. You'd think it would be more Division of Juvenile Services. But getting truancy diversion specialists to help, and now we have them in 27 counties. We didn't have that before. Now we have youth reporting centers expanded to different counties to have a place where it's an in-between between somebody going to an out-of-home placement and actually getting the types of educational services that they would otherwise need to receive. And also, one of the more recent things that the Department of Education has done is work on pilot programs for elementary schools and middle schools, taking some of the same STEM initiatives and workforce initiatives and trying to see if we can get a light bulb to go off in the head of a student who right now doesn't want to go to school. And these are very early on, but they're showing great promise. And so, Governor, I just want to thank you for letting me be a part of trying to be at this table and letting this initiative be something where I think it was referred to once, a lot of these initiatives are passed to help people get where they need to go to get a job. But sometimes, like board game Chutes and Ladders, you go up a ladder, but then every so often somebody makes a mistake. And I think this is a great example of how that's been able to work so well here.
Thank you. And also, this is the year when it was predicted we'd have to have that new $200 million prison that Justice Reinvestment prevented us from having to build. So thanks for your hard work on that, with those groups. Appreciate it. Keith, let's come back to you and talk about
Let's train.
Let's train.
Sure. And Governor, before I do that, I want to expand that topic just a hair to, although we're not doing this separately, one of the byproducts of this process was to try to identify ways to identify would-be entrepreneurs. And my director of the SBDC, Christine Oliver, is here today. They've done a remarkable job, as everyone has with limited resources, in trying to find not just everybody that thinks they ought to be in business, but those folks who have the right skill sets and that have a real opportunity to grow into small business people, which makes up 82% of the employers in the state of West Virginia have fewer than 20 employees. So the work that has been done by the SBDC has been very important in this overall training strategy for the state's economy. Having said that, I'll turn it back over to to Chelsea and let Chelsea kind of give you an update and overview of the Let's Train initiative.
All right. So Workforce West Virginia received a grant in 2014. It was a $6.1 million grant. Specifically, it was a USDOL job-driven national dislocated workers grant. Everybody at Workforce calls it the JDNEG grant. I can't remember those letters or what they stand for. So the first thing we did was decided we were going to rename the grant. So we renamed the grant program Let's Train West Virginia. The purpose of this program and the purpose of these funds is to take people in West Virginia who are long-term unemployed. So these are people who've been on unemployment for an extended period of time, or people who are at risk of losing their unemployment benefits, and get them back into the workforce. There were two components of the grant. There was one that dealt with classroom training, and then the second one was the one that our group and the marketing agency dealt with, and that was the on-the-job training. The way this program worked is the grant actually went to employers. So what we did is we did a bunch of outreach to reach out to the people who were unemployed, the people who were at risk of losing their benefits, but we also did outreach to employers. The way it worked is if an employer was going to hire somebody, and they would hire somebody from our list, or somebody who met these qualifications, somebody who was about to lose their benefits, the employer could be reimbursed for the first $10,000 of wages for that employee. So it turned out that for a lot of employers, this was a great program. It was a program that they came back and said, how many people can I take? Is there a limit? It was a great program. These employers found that they were getting valuable workers, just people who, you know, one thing or another got in the way and they lost their job at some point, but people who were skilled and people who could work, and it was allowing them to do this on-the-job custom training. So it's been a very successful program. We did this program a little different than we've done traditional workforce grant programs. Like I said, we renamed it, but we also did a lot of outreach, and we did outreach in different ways. We did ads in the movie theaters. We did coupons on the bottom of Dollar General and Family Dollar receipts that said, you know, unemployed, get paid for on-the-job training. We did advertising at the mall. We did some digital advertising, but we did a lot of different outreach methods to reach out to both the unemployed folks and the employers. I'm happy to report that today we have over 200 employers that we're working with, and we've placed over 100 different positions. We've used all of the classroom funding, and we're getting close on the on-the-job training. So it's been a very successful program. I think it's also indirectly brought a lot of people to Workforce. At the periods of time that we were doing the outreach, doing these different things, the ads and the receipts and these different things, we would see increases in our number of calls to the 1-800 number at Workforce and to our website. So I think it brought a lot of people in the doors. Whether or not they ended up with this program, they may have found another program that works better for their needs. But it's been an innovative and a fun project to work on.
All right. That's all I have for this.
Lastly, Governor, as you know, one of the recommendations of this group, the Workforce Planning Council, was to establish a working group that would essentially work to develop specific policy goals, priorities, legislation, any other kind of recommendations to bring forth back to the council. And today, I'm happy that we have a number of those members around the room. So, folks, I'm going to come around. The governor is providing you all with a certificate thanking you for all of your hard work. There were a number of legislative initiatives that you all helped us work through and draft over the last 2 years. So I'm going to come around and bring these to you all. And if you don't mind meeting me outside, we're going to get a quick photo here in a few minutes.
That's good seeing Larry Malone, my former. Always good seeing Corey Davis. Kind of educational lines.
Business chair.
Close.
I really do enjoy it. Okay. Thank you all so much for coming.